Well, Morgan, welcome to town.
Thank you.
And congratulations on POM Wonderful Presents, the greatest movie ever sold.
Just rolls off the tongue.
It does. It's so smooth.
It's like a delicious POM just rolling off your lips.
Explain to us first, what is it?
POM is a pomegranate juice. It's 100% pomegranate juice. And it is the proud sponsor, the above the title sponsor of the greatest movie ever sold. So it's the Etihad Stadium. It's the FedEx Field, the Qualcomm Stadium of the greatest movie.
So what did you have to offer them to get that? Your firstborn? What's the deal?
Charm, an amazing personality. I think, see, I even made myself joke on that. I think, for them, they saw it as a real kind of ingenious marketing opportunity for them that wasn't going to cost them a lot of money. You know, in the United States, to buy a 30-second TV spot in the Super Bowl will cost you $3 million, wow, not even including the cost of the commercial. Now we've made a film where they will have paid upwards of $1 million when all is said and done, that will have played all around the world, will have been seen on television, on DVD, on the internet, and it cost them a third of that. So it was pretty smart investing on their behalf.
Nevertheless, did they take some convincing?
Everybody took some convincing. Like every brand that I called, every company, and I called over 650, probably about 675 brands to sponsor this movie, of which most of them are like, listen, I already saw what you did to that other company. Why do I want to help you with this movie? I don't want anything to do with this. And so it took a long time of, being tenacious, being persistent, keep calling them back, say, no, it's not going to be like that. It's going to be a lot more fun, promise. Yeah.
That other company they're referring to, of course, is the Golden Arches, McDonald's, yes, from your incredibly successful documentary, Super Size Me. What has been the impact from that?
Well, it's been, with regards to this film, people called me back because of Super Size Me, but people also called me back to say no because of Super Size Me. So it was a win-win and a win-lose in a lot of ways with regards to making this film. But what made that work for the greatest movie is it made us have to find people who are really invested, really dedicated to the idea. I was pretty radioactive calling these people. I was that thing that's like, yeah, you just go play over there by yourself. We don't want anything to do with this.
You did have an impact on McDonald's themselves. I mean, yeah, after your doco, they started introducing all this healthy food. Do you take credit
suddenly,
for that?
Suddenly there were apples. it's like, whoa, look at that. It's an apple. And the only time I would ever want an apple from McDonald's if you jam a stick in it and deep fry it, But... they say all of these are just, it was all coincidences, had nothing to do with the film, which I personally don't believe, but it's up to them.
Yeah. Have you ever eaten it since?
I have. At the end of the movie, at the end of Super Size Me, there's the party scene, yes, where I'm celebrating never having to, that I'm done with the diet, I never have to go back. That was March 2nd, 2003. I have not walked in those doors since.
Wow.
Yeah.
Unlikely to ever do so, unless paid a lot of money, perhaps.
That's right. Well, we called them for this movie. Like, called them for Greatest Movie because the idea was to create, a blockbuster documentary, a docbuster. And you can't have a blockbuster film without a Happy Meal. That's why I would call them. So we have a great relationship, McDonald's and I. I leave messages, they never call me back. It works out really well. So I called over and over and over again, kept leaving message after message. I was like, hey, it's me. Call me back. It'll be different this time. Just give me a buzz. Never heard back. So, the end.
Classic. What to you are the movies, that all of us have seen where the product placement is just screamingly obvious?
There's so many. It's, whether it be, Casino Royale with James Bond, where he's talking about his watch and driving his Aston Martin, or down to my good friends at McDonald's again, who, years ago made a movie called Mac and Me, which was like, it was like retarded alien comes to Earth, only eats McDonald's. It was one of the worst movies you've ever seen. But in the middle of this movie, a dance sequence breaks out, it's like Ronald McDonald is suddenly there, dancing with the alien, and I was like, this movie's terrible. It's awful. But it's instances like that, that there's so many to choose from. Because especially now, more and more companies and more studios are doing it.
And why is there this increase, if you like, in the number of product placements that we're seeing in these big films?
Because of money. There's so much money at stake now in big Hollywood movies. Once you get above $40-50 million, that's real money, for studios. And if they're spending $200 million like they are on battleships or these Harry Potter films, which Harry Potter may not have product placement in the film, but they have tons of co-promotion, co-marketing partners where you can get the collector cup or the toys and the kids meal, you name it. But there's real money at stake.
Is there a movie that's made without any?
there's a lot of films that are made without it. You know, there's still there are still
people without subtitles.
Yeah, without there are ones that are made without it and in English.
All right, I'm just trying to think of
one. Like There Will Be Blood is a great example. You know, like There Will Be Blood didn't have any product placement in it. The Coen brothers tend not to have a lot of films, you know, that have a lot of product placement in it. So there are people who are working outside of the studio system who are still kind of, you know, a part of the system, but they're on the fringe. But still, once you start making like a big Hollywood, big studio movie, somebody's going to be on your shoulder saying, ding, ding, hey, could you have him hold this cup? You know, could he hold this burger in this scene? It happens.
Quentin Tarantino complains to you in the documentary, in the film, that he begged.
Yeah,
please,
nobody.
Denny's, let me come in.
Nobody wants to be in business with it. Nobody wanted it. It's like, so I was like, Quentin and I have a lot in common. It's like, they didn't want to be in your film. They didn't want to be in my film, you know, but... At the opening scene of Reservoir Dogs, you know, where they're all sitting around planning the heist, that was when he wrote the script, that was at Denny's. He, at the beginning of Pulp Fiction with Pumpkin and Honey Bunny, where they're talking about their relationship and what's going on, in a Denny's. I'm sure in both those instances, Denny's probably read the script and said, oh, and then this guy gets shot in the face? Oh, and so they're planning a robbery in our Denny's? Absolutely not. Oh, wait, the two people who are in there then get up to rob everyone that's in our restaurant? No, we probably don't want that either. So,
but they did order a good shake.
That's right.
You of course, made another film only a couple of years ago that was an incredible one, and that was
We're in the World of Osama Bin Laden.
Now, did you get close?
When they announced where he was and where they found him, there was a period where we were filming in Islamabad, the capital, and we were just on the outside doing kind of interviews in a neighborhood. And when we were in that neighborhood, we were about 20 miles from where they found him, which is pretty amazing.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That is incredible. So how did you feel when they found him?
I was kind of shocked. I was kind of blown away. I was really happy that, you know, that chapter was over, and you know that now, you know, we got him. You know, there's a great "we got him" moment there, that, you know, you can run, but you can't run forever. You know, we're gonna get you at some point. We're gonna get you. So I was great. I tell you what was amazing is, like, because when that film came out, the film was attacked and eviscerated by the press, got killed by people, and so then suddenly when they found Osama bin Laden, they found him in Pakistan. The next day, the phone's ringing off the hook. You know, journalists, CNN, Fox News saying, you were right. He was in Pakistan. You got to come talk to us. I was like, oh, now I'm right. You know, 3 years ago, I was an idiot. Now I'm right. It was amazing.
That's interesting. It's the way the world works.
That's right.
Another one you're working on, which I can't wait to see, I think you're in post, in the Comic-Con.
Yes.
Episode 4.
A Fan's Hope.
A Fan's Hope, which is a play on Star Wars Episode 4, which I love. Yeah. So you've gone and interviewed all the
all the fantastic geeks, all the people like me who are, like, you know, the super geeks of the world. You know, we went to San Diego Comic-Con, which is the largest comic book convention, you know, on the planet, this pop culture mecca, which now influences everything. It influences movies and TV shows and video games and, you know, anything that they call, what, quote-unquote, the popular arts. And so we followed 7 people into this amazing convention that now doesn't attract hundreds of people. 150,000 people from around the world go there. It's massive, and we tell the story of this place through their eyes. And we did the film with Stan Lee, you know, the creator of Spider-Man, Joss Whedon, who's directing the Avengers, Thomas Tull, the creator and CEO of Legendary Pictures, you know, which put out the 300 and the Watchmen, Harry Knowles, kind of the king of all geeks with Ain't It Cool News, you know. So we've got this little geek dream team that made the film, and that'll be out later this year.
That's awesome too. Yeah. God, where do you get all your ideas?
It depends. You know, it's most of my, I had this conversation with somebody recently. It's like, so he said to me, my friend said, you get a lot of ideas sitting on the couch watching TV. And I was like, and I was like, see, Mom was wrong. See, take that, Mom. All my ideas come from watching TV.
And look where
That's
you
right.
are now.
That's right. You could be getting an idea watching this interview right now. See, so stay on the couch. It's good for you.
All right. You're covered in sponsors there. We've got sponsors all over your body on the very attractive poster, by the way.
That's right.
Is there anyone?
It's a much larger card than necessary. But I just I like making myself feel better.
Is there anyone you need to thank in this television interview that's going to help you get where this film needs to go?
Well, we should thank everyone. We should thank, you know, Palm Wonderful, Hyatt, JetBlue, Carrera Sunglasses, Mini Cooper, Mane and Tail Shampoo, Sheets, you know, my good friends at Merrill's, the greatest shoe you'll ever wear, you know, KDF, you know, the list goes on and on, Petland Discounts, you know, get it for freeonline.com. It's so many people made this movie happen. If it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be here.
That's absolutely fantastic. Does it have to make a certain amount at the box office to pay off?
To pay, like, a Palm, who's the above-the-title sponsor, committed to $1 million. So to get to the full million, we have to hit certain benchmarks. We have to get 600 million media impressions worldwide, 250,000 screens worldwide, 500,000 downloads and DVDs, and $10 million at the box office. So, you know, right now we're inching through all those benchmarks, but I think we got a good shot.
Okay, and you want Australians to do their bit.
And Australians, you need to help me out. Everybody in Australia needs to, you know, get off the couch just this once. Just this once, get off the couch and go see Palm Wonderful Presents, the greatest movie ever sold.
Fantastic. Thanks so much, Morgan. That's great.
Cheers.